foreign creditors and bondholders are fully paid off. And what we're seeing is that electorates, if they're in the position to be able to vote on these policies, they often vote against the policies, the austerity policies. And if that happens, they're simply asked to vote again. It's happened in Ireland until they get the right outcome. And in Ireland, that's given rise to a very rich new vein of Irish humor. Even in this country, some of you may recall, in a very rare bipartisan vote in September 2008 in the House of Representatives, Congress actually rejected the first TARP bailout, $700 billion TARP bailout of the financial industry. And the bill was sent back, actually barely amended, a week later for a correct vote, which was given. So everywhere we look, elected officials are still being pressured to save the banks, pass on the costs of bankers' speculative investments to the most vulnerable populations. And our perception is that household debt, not just sovereign debt, but household debt has reached unsustainable levels. It cannot be paid off. It can never be paid off. And a large portion of it will have to be canceled. And this is not simply an economic challenge for everyone, the debtors, the creditors, and the national economic managers. It's also a critical crossroads for any democracy, because the historical record shows that when creditors are given too much power, the creditor class is given too much power in a society, that almost leads directly to debt peonage and slavery. Ancient societies were able to resolve this problem of debt slavery by royal fiat in the form of a jubilee or a periodic debt cancellation. But otherwise, if we're talking about societies that managed to become democracies, we see that they very quickly became oligarchies when the power of the creditor class went unchecked, which is pretty much the situation that we see in so many countries nowadays. We may soon reach this tipping point in many countries in the next decade, when the power of foreign bondholders and creditors to extract payments is pit directly against a democracy's national self-determination. So, like Occupy Wall Street, strike debt has operated under the assumption that our elected officials or legislators are simply not in a position to check, let alone regulate, the power of Wall Street creditors to extract rents through debt imposition. And in fact, the brutal suppression of the Occupy movement in 2011 and 2012 dramatized the extent to which state violence would be used to back up the creditor class. In this city alone, we saw the NYPD routinely violating the rights of protesters from first to last. It's a fairly transparent exercise or illustration of how they protected the interests of Wall Street. So, because lawmakers cannot do so, we believe that people will have to provide debt relief for themselves by any means necessary. Indeed, we believe the only way of salvaging popular democracy will be through asserting the right to refuse debts that were incurred illegitimately. And the question of what is an illegitimate debt is something that is very interesting to discuss. There's a concept, a legal concept, which goes by the name of odious debts. Odious debts are the legal term applied in the case of authoritarian rulers who borrow money from foreign banks without any citizen consent and then use the funds to personally enrich themselves. But we think the scope of odious debt should also be extended to individuals and households that are targeted by predatory lenders in all sorts of ways. In addition, when populations are forced to privately debt finance basic social needs, basic social goods, which is increasingly the case in our society, we should call these antisocial debts at the very least, and probably much worse than that, find much worse labels than that. The Chinese, more poetically, the Chinese call these debts the three mountains of education, housing, and healthcare debt, all weighing very heavily on the burdens of the people. 76% of American households are now in very serious debt, and one in seven of these are being pursued and harassed by debt collectors. And even those without personal loans are also debtors, because municipal debt has been structured in such a way that the service costs are now routinely passed on to the most vulnerable populations in the form of public employee wage cuts, slashed services, and regressive taxation. You can look at it in city after city across the country. Wall Street lending practices are producing the same kind of austerity policies that are being visited on electorates in Southern Europe and the Global South populations before them, which were delivered into the debt trap by policies of structural adjustment. As a result, we're seeing debt default. Levels of debt default are rising like floodwaters. And we know that individuals, at least, who suffer default suffer the consequences in personal isolation with a very profound consequences. Depression, divorce, suicide can often follow. And so by contrast, we strike debt, at least, among other things, we advocate collective action in the form of debt refusal, debt repayment refusal. Some sovereign governments have taken this path: Ecuador, Argentina, Iceland. And we think it's time to launch the civil society equivalent of what these sovereign governments have done. So let me describe some of our work now. Strike Debt formed last summer in June. Most of what we did through the summer was to run debtor assemblies, open debtor assemblies in New York City parks. Last September, on the first anniversary of Occupy Wall Street, we released and circulated the Debt Resistors Operations Manual, which was our first public service project. It's written in plain English and basically offers practical advice to debtors of all kinds about how to escape from underneath the burden of debt and evict the power of creditors from your lives. It was conceived as an act of mutual aid, and we circulated it far and wide. And we're working on a second expanded edition now, because since it's a living document, we invited all readers to send in their comments and their additional content. So we gathered all of that up and are expanding a lot of the chapters into something that will be even more useful, we hope. It's being translated into other languages, and we hope it will be customized in different countries, because every country has its own debt economy that's quite specific to the conditions in other parts of the world. So making available this kind of advice is part of our commitment to public education about how the debt system functions. And this is a very important part of our work, because Wall Street has a very self-serving response to criticism of its practices. Wall Street tends to say that the finance business is too complicated for lay people to understand, much too complicated, so don't go there. We feel that every public revelation about how the debt system is rigged helps to erode the powerful ideology that keeps the finance sector in business, and the most powerful part of that ideology is the morality of personal debt repayment. This belief that repaying your debts is a highly moral test of personal responsibility is the glue that holds the financialized economy together. So any effort that helps to erode that very powerful belief is we feel a step in the right direction. Our second large project was called the Rolling Jubilee, and it offered a different, slightly more innovative kind of public education. This was a campaign that raised money to buy distressed debt for pennies on the dollar. A lot of distressed debt gets sold on the secondary debt market, and it passes through various hands, and it's sold very cheaply, and at the very end of the chain, it's in the hands of debt collectors who then come after you and try to collect on the full amount of the debt, but they buy it very cheaply. So we found a way into that market and are working with debt buyers to buy up distressed debt, and instead of collecting on it, we abolish it. So the Rolling Jubilee struck a chord with a lot of folks who heard about it, and we raised a lot of money in a matter of a few weeks. We raised about $500,000, and we only expected to raise about a tenth of that. Because you can buy the debt very cheaply, that means we can buy $10 million worth of debt with that sum. And aside from helping out many of the debtors, what we call the people's bailout, the whole point of it was to help expose the predatory nature of this murky marketplace in secondary debt. Because people who pick up the phone and have to listen to these debt collectors are generally not aware of how cheaply their debts are bought. And it changes the psychology of the debtor when you know that. In addition, very few people know that the original lenders get to charge off their defaulted accounts and also take a tax break, which is another kind of bailout. Before bundling those debts into big portfolios for sale on the secondary market. So the Rolling Jubilee was, of course, not designed as a solution to the debt crisis. It certainly wasn't designed as a long-term feasible solution to the debt crisis. It's a relatively small amount of money, but it's a highly symbolic act. And also a chance to offer support and solidarity to people. Last week we completed $1 million medical debt buy, and we only paid $10,000 for this $1 million worth of medical debt, mostly from emergency rooms in Indiana and Tennessee. So these are people who were pretty desperate, got sick, and couldn't pay their debts. Now, just before the launch of the Rolling Jubilee, other Occupy Wall Street remnants, some of you may be here, sprang up to bring relief to the communities very hard hit by Hurricane Sandy. And the very spontaneous self-organization of Occupy Sandy proved to be more rapid, flexible, and effective than anything provided by government agencies. And this was widely recognized at the time. The local community-minded initiatives of Occupy Sandy were a very practical demonstration of the Occupy ethos of mutual aid. And to a lot of people, they demonstrated that the Zuccotti Park prototype could be extended, could be scaled up or extended in the form of a resilient outreach program far beyond the traditional constituency of Occupy Wall Street. A lot of our organizers in Strike Debt played a very central role in Occupy Sandy, setting up and running field operations in Staten Island and the Rockaways. And we produced a research report that revealed that other sources of relief in the form of loans to the distressed communities, loans that were offered through government agencies or from private banks, were on the verge of driving the victims of the hurricane much deeper into debt as a result. Classic case of disaster capitalism in action. And so at the time, and there continues to be a lot of discussion about debt-free reconstruction and recovery in the affected communities. So both the Rolling Jubilee and Occupy Sandy generated a lot of goodwill, and their example sparked a lot of new ideas and action plans. We established relationships with European anti-debt groups that are fighting austerity policies or are conducting or want to conduct citizen audits of public or sovereign debt. Religious communities in particular responded to the Rolling Jubilee with a lot of enthusiasm, partly because they sensed an opportunity to revive the tradition, the Jubilee tradition, within their own faiths, in their own backyards. A lot of those faith communities have been involved in Jubilee South coalitions of the last 15 years or so to try and bring debt relief to Global South populations. And the Rolling Jubilee, they saw an opportunity to bring this issue to their own backyards, to their own constituencies, many of whom were heavily indebted. Some folks in Strike Debt have set ourselves the goal of building a debtors' union at some point with national or even international scope, although we recognize and have realized pretty quickly that organizing around debt is a very difficult thing to do. It's not. It's quite different from organizing around wage labor, as wages, after all, have a collective character, and as do wage struggles. By contrast, debts are highly individualizing, debtors are often too ashamed or guilty to make themselves known to each other. So there's not a lot of fellow feeling involved, even among a group of debtors. Many of you in this room will have debt, but the way you think about it won't necessarily overlap, and you will be in debt to different institutions. So organizing you into a debtors' union or the local of a debtors' union would not be very easy at all. Would require kind of extraordinary means. Even so, the history of debtors' movements show that it can be done, and I guess we think that under the current circumstances there really is an alternative, that it will have to be done one way or another. But we think we're only really at the beginning of this journey. It's a very long process of building the grounds for a debtors' movement. Let me say a few words about the uneven social impact of debt. Because one of the things we've encountered, which is widely believed, is that indebtedness is a middle-class problem, right? It's only for people who can afford mortgages, or only for people who can afford student debt to go to college. Most of the world's population, after all, is too poor to have access to debt. And so it's assumed they're largely unaffected. And this belief or this presumption is really entirely inaccurate. Low-income people who are unbanked or underbanked are actually forced into the worst kind of debt trap, because they have to rely on alternative or fringe financial services that are barely regulated. And in most cases, these are lenders that prey upon the poor through cutthroat services. And you're familiar probably with some of them, but there's a long list of these services: check cashing outlets, rent-to-own finance, auto-title lending, pawn shops, prepaid credit cards, payday loan agencies, which are probably the most notorious because of the rates of interest that they charge. They can extract from 800% to 1,000% of loan interest annually. And if you take out online loans, the rates of interest can be even higher than that. Really extortionate rates of interest. This whole spectrum of fringe finance carries many hidden fees, and of course rates of interest that are astronomically higher than that of traditional commercial loans. So these are usurious rates of interest. They would be illegal in most societies, and historically they have been pretty much illegal here. But if you add them all up in the aggregate, as an industry, they collectively extract an annual average of $2,500 from some of the poorest households in the U.S. In fact, they collect $2,500 from each of the 40 million households that earn under $30,000 a year. So $2,500 of $30,000 is a big chunk of income that is extracted from these by these lenders. These are the poorest people in the U.S. They're too poor to borrow from banks. And yet the payments extracted from them are greater in proportion to their income than the payments, the debt payments extracted by Citibank or the Bank of America from their qualified middle-class borrowers. Which is why increasingly we see the big banks getting into the payday loan business here, because they recognize that lending to the poor is actually very, very profitable, more profitable than lending to the middle class in certain ways. And they're also getting into the micro-lending business in Global South countries, because that's also a sector where interest rates can be very high. So don't be fooled by this myth that debt is only a problem for folks with good credit scores. It's not true. If you have no credit scores, if you have no access to banking at all, you're much likely to be closer to a condition of debt peonage than if you are fully banked. How does indebtedness affect our access to paid work and livelihoods? One of the things we can talk about here is student debt. As a result of the student debt crisis in the U.S., many graduates increasingly talking about their condition as being one akin to indenture, which is a very inflammatory word for people. But if you think about it, being obliged to take on debt in order to labor, which is what student debt is, gives you access to the knowledge economy. You have to go into debt in order to labor. That is the essence of indenture, for the most part. The traditionally indentured, if we could refer to them that way, and today they include millions of migrant workers who cross borders owing recruitment and transit fees. Traditionally indentured generally pay off their bonds fairly quickly because there's employment readily available to them. That's not the case with current levels of student debt. They won't be paid off very quickly, and they may not be paid off in the working lifetime of many people. In fact, at the current level of default, 1 million student debtors defaulted in the course of the last year, which is an astonishing number. These rates of default, they will never be paid off. It's pretty clear they will not be paid off. The situation is entirely unsustainable. And among other things, it doesn't just pose a grave threat to the indebted, it also poses a grave threat to the national economic managers of the American dream, right? The people who are in charge of the American dream, because here you have a generation coming into maturity with those kinds of levels of debt that will never be able to afford to buy a home, won't be able to afford probably to have children, won't be able to afford high-priced consumer items that are all absolutely crucial to the economic engine. And that's a big problem for the national economic managers. Now, if student debtors are lucky enough to find paid work, their wages are more and more being used to pay off the debts incurred simply to prepare themselves for employability. An increasingly larger share of wages is going to service the debts incurred simply to meet the basic mental and physical requirements that are demanded for modern knowledge work. And there's all sorts of additional fees that are involved in this. Mental and physical upkeep is something that we're being asked to take on for ourselves. They include things like gym membership fees, which are pretty costly and are pretty much obligatory now. When I was a youth, it would be considered pretty freakish to actually go to the gym, even for gay men. Nowadays, completely and utterly obligatory to have to go to the gym. Costs like increased costly nutrition, because if you try and survive on, you know, a basic American processed food diet, that will make you very sick. There's all sorts of costs that are incurred there. Preventative medicine, among other therapies, to reduce stress. There's a whole long list of fees that are not considered ancillary, but also obligatory, that are required to keep the well-tempered knowledge worker in the right kind of mind-body balance, to be able to be attuned to work demands and so on and so forth. And that's just before you find employment. Add on to this the cost of upskilling, because the given wisdom is that now, in this country at least, that everyone now needs a master's degree. A bachelor's degree is not enough. You need a master's degree to compete in the knowledge economy. These are very expensive. There's hardly any financial aid available for master's degrees. And they're one of the biggest magnifiers of student debt, actually. And then, you know, throw in the cost of self-support during at least one unpaid internship, but probably, you know, two or three unpaid internships, because that's considered also now an obligatory gateway into the knowledge economy. So the time and resources expended on all of these basic needs how do student debtors perceive them? They perceive them as a hedge. And I use the term advisedly, it's a financial term. They perceive them as a hedge against falling below the threshold of employability in the decades that lie ahead. And although it's unfortunate that many students approach education with that mentality, I can hardly blame students from doing so, given those circumstances. But this kind of calculating outlook, where you perceive education debt as a hedge against the future, is part of the financial, is part of the mentality of a financialized society. A financialized society is one that has exhausted its capacity for profit making in the present, and in order to profit, it circulates ever more paper claims on the future, which is what debt is. These are claims on the future wages of the population. Borrowing is always an act of renouncing the future, especially when high or compound interest rates swallow up great chunks of it. But to the degree to which debts are now consuming the wages of the future, because that's what they are, to the profit of the finance industry, I find myself thinking more and more of student debt as a form of wage theft. Or at least as a kind of tax that is exacted by the finance industry on a future workforce. Again, there's a big political element to this. There's a point, a kind of tipping point that you reach when the cost of servicing the debt surpasses the actual value of the debt. And there's a point societally when the premise of a democracy to deliver an improved future for all of its participants is then in jeopardy. And I think we've reached that point in the U.S. certainly, and it's particularly egregious in the case of democracies like the U.S. because so much of the reputation of U.S. democracy was built on the creation of a relatively stable middle class in the mid-20th century. It was a pinnacle achievement. So I personally, as a college professor, I'm employed here at NYU at an institution which generates among the highest student debt burdens in the nation. And I'm more and more persuaded that debt finance education is fundamentally immoral, foreclosing the future of generations is a very self-destructive path for any society. I think even worse is allowing Wall Street financiers to feed off their predicament. This is just a fundamental violation of common humanity. And I got into this movement, the debtors' movement, because I simply couldn't walk into NYU classrooms anymore without thinking really hard about the predicament of the fact that my salary, in part, is being paid by my students going further and further into debt. And there's a lot of denial on the part of the professoriate about this, and I can understand the denial. On the one hand, I think professors feel that they're not to blame for skyrocketing college costs. For the most part, their salaries have been stagnant, or if you look at the overall instructional costs at universities over the last 15, 20 years, they've been sliced because of casualization, because more and more of the teaching is done by adjuncts. So in the aggregate, instructional costs have actually decreased. In addition, professors have feel besieged enough. They don't want to invite some other reason to undercut their credibility. That said, I think academics could be doing a lot more than they currently are in speaking out about student debt. We certainly don't hear a lot, or if anything, from the top. Top administrators and college presidents have said virtually nothing about student debt, at least nothing of note, in the last decade, and certainly since the crisis emerged. And largely because their pockets have been lined by this system. Their astronomical salaries rise disproportionately to all other employees in the university. And NYU is a very good case in point. Our senior administrators earn astronomical salaries, obscenely high salaries. And the rate at which they increase every year is also obscenely high. They seem content to weather the current storm over student debt. I think it's unlikely that costs will stabilize until demand falls off, and that's not going to happen very quickly, although it's beginning to do so. There's been a 2% decrease in applications this year. Whether that has anything to do with student debt, I don't know, but quite possibly. But even if there's a fall off in domestic demand, there will be an increase in overseas demand. The rising middle class in many fast-developing countries are clamoring for seats in top-brand universities. And analysts put the growth rate at 80% over the next decade. 80% growth in the global higher education market. And, you know, investors look at numbers like that and they start salivating. And that's one of the reasons why certainly one of the reasons why universities are rushing offshore, as our university is doing, and increasingly will do, to make up for any shortfall in domestic demand. Now, again, another point I want to make about the uneven social impact of this: the single largest student debts are racked up by students from middle-income families seeking a private university degree at colleges like this one. They are the poster children for student debt, and media producers like to feast on their stories because they're seen as so profligate in a way. But the overall impact of student debt is magnified among low-income families, and it's certainly reflected in the statistics about race. 81% of African-American students, 67% of Latino students who earn bachelor degrees leave their schools with debt, as compared to 64% of white students. Disparities in the default rates are even greater, with African Americans defaulting at 4 times the rate of whites right now. You also find students of color and low-income students generally are much more likely to enroll in for-profit schools, which have very high non-completion rates and account for nearly half of student loan defaults. These proprietary colleges, we should actually call them Wall Street's colleges, because that's what they are. They're owned by Wall Street, although they're never referred to that way. They engage in reverse redlining, explicitly target students of color for recruitment, loading them with debt in return for a less than useful education. And I think one of the worst examples, I don't know if any of you have heard about this or are aware of it, one of the worst examples I could point to is the new GI Bill. The new GI Bill was introduced in Congress in 2008 to help veterans of the wars in Iraq and Afghanistan have access to higher education. And what's happened is that almost a third of the GI Bill monies have ended up in the coffers of these proprietary colleges. And that's happened because they exploit a legislative loophole. The for-profit colleges are allowed to operate if they can raise 10% of their revenue from sources other than government loans. Because most of the revenue comes from federal student loans. And they through this loophole, they've been able to count the GI Bill monies as part of that 10%. I mean, this is money that comes from the government, but they managed to count it as part of the 10%. So they've been very effective at capturing a lot of that money. The result has been a very aggressive recruitment of ex-soldiers. In some of the cases were. Vets who were so brain damaged from their injuries, they had no idea what they were signing when the recruiters came after them. And overall, there's an inevitable impact on veterans of color who served disproportionately in the armed services. So what you're seeing then is, you know, the second GI Bill was supposed to be inclusive and to be able to generate benefits for minorities that were excluded from the first GI Bill back in the 1950s. And what we're finding is a lot of these communities being preyed upon now by admissions counselors, financial counselors in the for-profit colleges. So if I had to start anywhere with ending the debt financing of higher education, it would certainly be by abolishing Wall Street's colleges, which depend entirely on the ready availability of federal loans. Many obstacles to that. They have a very formidable lobbying presence on Capitol Hill, including many high-profile ex-politicians. Richard Gephardt is one of them. Dick Gephardt was one of the lions of Congress, one of the liberal lions of Congress. He goes to bat for the for-profit colleges. The Occupy Student Debt campaign, which is a campaign I worked on before we formed Strike Debt, we campaigned on a variety of measures designed to put an end to the debt financing of higher education. They included federal financing of all public tuition fees. We estimated it would only cost $70 billion a year to pay the tuition fees of everyone at 2- and 4-year colleges in the country. We also campaigned for zero interest loans, for full fiscal transparency, and Jubilee style cancellations of existing debts. We reckoned that to get to that point would require not necessarily a sympathetic congressional bloc, but a full blown debtors movement prepared to engage in debt refusal and reject the moralism of individual debt repayment. And I guess since 2008, we've seen a lot of public exposure of the workings of Wall Street and the debt economy. We've seen a double standard being put on public exposure. The fact that the banks and bankers are not expected to pay their debts, while the little people are. And so we have to figure out ways to break down and erode the moralism that is part and parcel of debt repayment. And part of doing that is to try to get people to understand what happens when lenders appear to lend money to borrowers. And I say appear because the money doesn't exist hitherto, for the most part. Fatally, I think, the public imagination still retains the image of a lender, you know, going off to the bank vault and picking up a bag of money, bringing it in, and somehow it gets transferred to a borrower. That's not the way that loans work. That's not the way that money comes into existence. Money is created as a result of our fractional reserve banking system. Money is created almost as if by magic. Money is created at the very moment that you sign a loan agreement. It doesn't exist hitherto. It comes into existence when you actually sign the loan agreement. And not only that, the money is not deducted from the bank's accounts. On the contrary, the bank actually adds to its assets the full amount to be paid back over the lifetime of the loan. So if my daughter, for example, borrows $50,000 to help pay for college tuition, the bank will have created for itself, say, $90,000 or whatever amount it imagines it will get back from this $50,000, and it will have added $90,000 to its assets simply by adding that number on a computer screen and counting it as an asset. And that money did not previously exist. So this kind of asset growth, none of which is actually earned, appears as if by magic, and it also generates the more advanced fantasy that through the magic of compound interest alone, fictitious capital can somehow grow and expand the economy in all sorts of ways, because these assets that have been added to the bank's list of holdings count then as part of GDP. This is irrational. I'm tempted to go into GDP, but actually I think I'm going to end there and show you some slides, which are much more fun, I hope, and much more creative, because this is about creative activism. After all, I haven't been very creative in my comments. So these are just some illustrations of what Strike Debt has done really since last summer. These were the first sparsely attended but very intense debtors assemblies, when people stood up and talked about their debts in public, because it's a very important coming out ritual in the debtors movement for people to openly speak about their debts and cast off the shame and guilt that is attached to being in debt. Some of these are direct actions, some of them are symbology, the work of creating symbols. And the red square is, for those of you who don't know, was sort of borrowed and adapted and customized from the Quebec movement, the Quebec student movement, that was so successful and so phenomenal. And we adopted the red square to signify the four corners of debt: medical, housing, education, and credit card debt. And one of the reasons for forming the coalition really was because we figured that when people look at debt, they tend to fix on single kinds of debt, like student debt. But it's more important to look at how debt flows through a household. Different kinds of debt flow through a household. In any one household, you will find medical debt, you'll find education debt, you'll find housing debt, you'll find credit card debt, and they're all interconnected. And when one goes into default, it has this very pernicious impact on all the others invariably, and that's what puts households under. So it's important to see how they're all connected. You Are Not Alone was a much discussed motto that we decided to adopt as a fan of a Liverpool football club, for whose motto is "You'll never walk alone." It has a personal significance for me. Someone here responsible for that? Great illuminator. I like this one. Title is a magazine that is edited by people are central to the organizing of strike debt. I think it's, well, correct me if I'm wrong, but it's probably the only Occupy publication that's still regularly publishing, is it? I think so, yeah. I should have brought along copies this evening, but they're available at a lot of locations around here. We don't have any on this floor, do we? We should have, yeah. The debt boulder, you can any direct action events. Arrest taking place. One of them of yours truly, in J.P. Morgan Chase last September 17th. Slavoj Zizek with strike debt. And this was for the telethon, a big event we did at Poisson Rouge here in November the 15th last fall, which was the telethon where we raised a lot of money for the Rolling Jubilee. I think this is supposed to be a response to some of our critics. Press coverage. This is on the left is the Detroit strike debt chapter. One of the things that happened after Rolling Jubilee was that strike debt chapters began to spring up in other cities, and they customized their own symbols and so on and so forth. That's the Detroit, what is it, Detroit Pistons? The Tigers, right. These are some of the gift boxes that we, on the left, that we sent to the debtors whose debts we'd abolished. This is the children's radical theater group called the Little Red Squares. They perform, debt-specific versions of fairy tales. Now that's a good one to end on. Thank you. Yeah. Who has questions or comments or?
Yeah, the debt union idea, the debtors union idea, which has long seemed to me maybe the most promising. I mean, this question of how to organize around debt, really, because the pedagogical debt is very heavy. So how do you, how do you get people to understand themselves? Of their own collectivity, right, and like their collective power. I'm just wondering, you seem to sort of indicate that this was sort of a maybe long-term visionary goal that's sort of unrealistic, I'm wondering if there's been much, discussion around how debtors unions would be formed, like around like the creditor, could debt unions be formulated in a way where collective power could be utilized? What the discussions have been?
Well, there's been a lot of discussion and kind of fledgling efforts, but the enormity of the task is so profound. We did have an organizing committee that thought about breaking down the country into TERF, like traditional organizers, and covering particular areas and trying to beat the bushes in each of these regions of the country. We thought that we could develop the existing strike debt chapters as nodes that would also do some of the regional organizing. We had planned, there were lots of ideas. One of them was that if there was sufficient critical mass of people that signed on, they could create sub-unions within the financial institutions to which they owed money. So say there was a significant block of people who owed money to the Bank of America, they would constitute a sub-union, a Bank of America sub-union, and perhaps be able to launch some kind of organized debt resistance within that grouping.
Yeah.
I guess that kind of discussion continues, but our initial efforts to really think about launching a national organizing initiative foundered just because of the enormity of the task, I think, and also because we couldn't agree really on an effective organizing strategy. So I think we decided to step back and continue discussing and wait for things to develop and have some exercise some revolutionary patience. I think that would be the best way of answering the question. But it's clear there's an appetite out there. I mean, people are certainly in the wake of ruling Jubilee. We got thousands of communications from people who were not just turned on by the ruling Jubilee as a concept, but also wanted to join something like a debtors' union.
You said there were examples of successful debt strikes in history. Can you talk about one?
Probably the most recent one would have been in Mexico, El Barzón, which was after the devolution of the peso, a lot of the debt burden that resulted. In the 1990s, and a lot of the debt burden fell on the lower middle class, farmers or proprietors, and they organized. I mean, it was very class specific, actually, among that particular class fraction. And they organized this movement, which was very effective. They had a lot of symbology too. They rode horses into state legislatures and so on and so forth. And I think their motto was, "We know that we owe, but we want to pay only a fair share."
Right.
So it wasn't outright debt refusal. It was a kind of a deal. A renegotiated deal that was being asked for. I think they were very effective, and they certainly played a role in dislodging from power, or effectively knocking off its pedestal one-party rule in Mexico. There's some vestiges of it in rural areas, but I don't think it's active anymore. But they were very effective at community level. They ran debt clinics. in rural areas and villages. Really extraordinary form of organization. Yeah.
Towards the end of your talk, you mentioned the way that money is created when people go into banks, and at the moment of the lending, the money is created. It didn't exist before. That's very accurate, and as a matter of fact, the fact is, I believe, that all of the money that's in existence today, trillions of dollars, every single one of it represents initially a debt. So if you want to know how much debt there is on the planet, you could say pretty much whatever money, excuse me, whatever money's out there is debt. So to put that in a very simple term, it is absolutely an overwhelming amount of debt that has, it's a debt overhead for everyone from the individual to the cities to the states to the nation.
Mm-hmm.
Most of us owe to some, and it's a totally inequitable situation. So the question is, no matter how much you strike at the debt, a bit here, a bit there, get a forgiveness here, a jubilee here, even if, supposing you could almost wipe out the debt, two things. One, you would wipe out all the money in existence, i.e. our medium of exchange, which allows commerce, etc., to occur, so that wouldn't be useful. But worse than that, if you didn't change the system, within time, everything would go back again. Because every time the new money was created, it would be in the form of debt.
Mm.
So as we say today, our money is debt-based. So my question is really what the strike debt, everything you're doing now is, trying to think of the term, when you go into the hospital, you're bleeding badly, they have
triage,
right? You know, to stop the bleeding.
Mm-hmm.
You want, you know, you, everything you're doing is triage.
Yeah.
And what I think needs to be done is to get, while the triage is being done, which is absolutely necessary, we have to begin a serious discussion about preventive medicine.
Yes.
About how people don't get sick in the first place.
Yeah.
And that translates into changing our monetary system.
Mm-hmm.
Because as long as you have a monetary system that creates all money as debt,
mm-hmm.
there's no logical way to escape the mm-hmm. debt burden.
Mm-hmm.
So I would hope at some point, as strike debt, you know, obviously you said, it helps individuals, and that's useful. It puts debt on the table as an issue to be discussed. But the next step is to really open up the view to the whole structural basis of our monetary system and its connection to debt, so that the dots begin to connect. And I haven't heard much. I've attended a few of the strike debt and other well-meaning organizations,
mm-hmm.
and it's really not that complicated of an issue to grasp, but somehow people just feel it's such a huge, overwhelming thing. You know, change the capitalist monetary system that, you know, nobody wants to consider it. But if you don't strike at the root, you're never going to,
yeah. Again, I think revolutionary patience is the tenor of the response to that. That's not to say one defers fighting for those remedies. But when you're faced with the current situation, where the immediate response is to think about relieving a burden. That's where mutual aid comes in, and that's where you. Where you test whatever reputation you want to build on as a broker, and as a relief provider in some way. But ultimately, I guess we believe that it's all about self-empowerment, that people have to take on this for themselves and build alternative communities and alternative economies. And that happens in all sorts of ways. Reforming the monetary system, we're certainly not at that step. I would say, however, that there are some debts. In general, we're inclined to advocate for non-debt repayment, but we think there's some debts that should be paid, and those include climate debts. Climate debt is one debt that should be repaid. Climate debt is a debt that reverses the creditor-debtor patterns, especially when it comes to the relationship between global north and global south populations. And the more you think about climate debt, the more of an insight you have into the potential for reversing those arrangements. We're talking about centuries of extraction. We're talking about centuries now of carbon-rich industrialization, and the beneficiaries of which have been in the global north. And the accumulated historical debt from that industrialization, from the carbon impact of it, has to be repaid in some way or another. World Bank and the International Monetary Fund recognize it. I mean, they recognize that climate change is one of the biggest threats or economic challenges of the 21st century. But they haven't gotten to the point where they're pressuring rich countries to actually recognize and pay the climate debt. Although I think that's sort of inevitable at a certain point. Currently, Washington doesn't recognize its obligations. It wants to see any climate financing as a form of aid, and doesn't want to get into recognizing there's the language of reparations is one in which we were complicit and face some responsibility. So that's one debt I think that has to be repaid. And how that gets played out is a very important part of the debt economy too. That has very large scale ramifications for the 21st century. No.
Okay.
No, you can't. You are the only person who cannot buy your own debt. How fucked up is that?
But I could feasibly buy somebody else's debt.
You could find someone else to buy it for. In fact, I don't know if you ever saw anyone seen the Queen of Versailles documentary about the guy who owns the what is it he owns? These timeshare resort business, and he boasts in the documentary, he boasts about all the things he's done, most of them nefarious, but one of the things he boasts about is how he was indebted, had a very large debt to some financial institution, was not able to pay it off, was not able to bargain it down, so he got one of his friends in Wall Street to approach the bank and offered to buy it at a reduced amount, which he was able to do. And then he sold the debt to this fellow. I mean, this is the crony system, this is how they do it. In a way, it was just their own version of the Rolling Jubilee.
Yeah.
But they do this kind of stuff all the time. You cannot, however, we don't know in advance whose debts are inside the portfolio that we're buying. We can target by zip codes. Yeah, we can target by zip codes, and we're trying to target the zip codes of particularly distressed communities. But beyond that, you really don't know what's inside that bundle. So sorry.
Logistically, then you couldn't really do that. I couldn't buy the
You could buy everything in your zip code, but actually you couldn't because they're all they're bundled according to varying degrees of risk, and what the likelihood would be of collecting on those debts. Obviously, the ones that are cheapest are the ones that are least likely to be collected on. So. For us, again, it's not a solution in any way. It's an opportunity to do some education with. So last week, as part of the medical debt buy, we worked with a bunch of healthcare activist groups and formed this coalition to provide a lot of public education about the inequalities of medical debt. So each time we do a big debt buy, will be an opportunity to do that. So it's a kind of formula for activism going forward, because the Rolling Jubilee has proven to be and just a very cool idea for people to think about. And each time we do a debt buy will be an opportunity to rekindle the exuberance that it generates in some new format. And creative people can imagine all sorts of direct actions around that could scale up. Potentially. So it's really a formula for activism for as long as the funding remains there, and at $10,000 for a $1 million buy, that's a lot of actions, a lot of buys.
It's to settle an argument that I have with somebody, it's
probably
such
won't
a
be.
Brilliant symbolic action. It's a brilliant idea. It immediately kindles the imagination. Is there a difference practically on the ground between buying a bunch of debt of people versus, let's say, telling them they don't really have to pay it, but there's a way out of that debt simply not paying it? Does it have practical value to the people that you do buy the debt of?
We don't know the answer to that because no one so far has responded. I mean, they probably will. This is a fairly big buy, involving hundreds of people, so we probably will get a response. The first one was relatively small, but in a lot of cases, people have gone off the grid, or they've changed their addresses, or I mean, our efforts to reach those people won't largely be successful. So a lot of those folks won't actually know that their debts have been abolished. I mean, not immediately. But there's not much we can do about that, quite frankly.
Except that's the whole the risk pool that you're going after too. The riskiest one probably the people that are hardest to get in touch with.
Hardest to get in touch
with. And also least likely to pay, obviously.
Right. But again, it's not a practical, it's not necessarily driven by a practical, I mean, some people will do some good along the way, abolishing debts for some debtors, but the point is that it's a vehicle for public intervention is the main, and the fact that we are targeting medical debt is the least reproachable of all debts in a way.
The morality of home of mortgage debt has come into question because of the housing crisis that was created by subprime lending and loans. So there's still this question about whether that's really legitimate debt. I think culturally.
I think for a lot of people, yes. Although there's a large sector of the population that will still still believes that, you know, there's a lot of there was a lot of speculation involved. People took on debt to trade up and so on and so forth. These aren't the kinds of thoughts that attach themselves to emergency room debt. It's the least reproachable of them all. It's the least likely to be attacked as a way of encouraging people to think they get away, they got away with it. No way. Yeah.
I work at the YES Lab, which is the YES Men's Activist Workshop. We work with organizations that want to do creative actions. And because the role of family is, as you said, it's like such an exciting idea. It's a teaching tool because it's engaging
like just thrilling. There's inherent excitement to it. I wondered
if you could talk a little bit about how you landed on that idea, or how you
approved it. Well, thank you. It was really only one of a whole slew of ideas that were sent to us on the Occupy Student Debt campaign. And it was Thomas Gokey's idea initially, and seemed like a pretty good idea, but there were lots of other good ideas too. And it kind of just hung around for a while and germinated, and then last summer people thought we should try and give it a go. There are others also that are kind of in reserve right now that we're thinking about mulling over, but haven't acted on, that may be equally good. I can't reveal them, but they come to us. People send these ideas in, as Gokey did, and we thought it was a little hokey at first, quite frankly, but it stuck around, and he started showing up for our assemblies and helped to convince us it was worth a try. So there are others. We should get together and share them with you, see if we can develop them through the YES Lab.
Great.
Okay. Anyone want to talk about their own debts? It's always an opportunity. Melissa, you've already done this once today. You don't have to. But it's a ritual. And no strike debt event is complete without.
I was doing at NCC. I had first narrative in terms of I had to rip off the credit cards after I got paid off, and they were invited to go out with my friend, give me all the cash, and use that cash to pay my rent. And the more I would spend on my credit card, they would extend my limit. Just when I think that, oh no, this is it, I'm going to sleep in my car, they would further my limit. And eventually, I mean, it's bubble bursts. You used to end up sleeping in your car. But I decided to, I was in a position where as I was a young person with no college education, a high school dropout, from an immigrant family, living amongst a certain socioeconomic means that didn't allow me to have further myself that way. And so I decided to go to my mother's home country and live for a few years and duck out, and walked away to Brazil, and I walked away from my debt. And I'm just now clear in that aspect, but I've now cured 68K of student loan debt that I have walked into. So, and I also have medical debt from an accident. I have it in my bag. ER visit, I was in an accident. And even with the co-pays with the student health insurance that's mandatory by NYU, I still have 1,500K worth of debt in my, you know, bills in my pocket. I'm trying to call and deal with it. So the only pillar I don't deal with is a mortgage, but ain't nobody giving me a mortgage. So that's my debt experience. This is why this is very passionate. I mean, this is very real.
through a cycle of non-repayment.
I didn't realize that I was
right.
It wasn't a conscious act of resistance.
Right.
It was, I have nothing else, I have no other so it was, yeah, it was survival. It was my only option. I took the last $800 that I had and bought a ticket to Brazil.
We have a lot of medical debt, my wife and me.
You do?
Yeah, and we have been sued, gone to court, because I've been paying part of it, but it's just accumulates and they appear from nowhere. And it was because when I was a student at NYU, I couldn't cover her health insurance. So that's something that I am from the system for.
Visualize.
Oh well, it's gonna be done in now. I have health insurance for her already, and I in about 3 years that's done.
I'm 65. I basically ran a very small business as a cabinet maker, custom cabinet maker, and having graduated college with a BA in philosophy, I was unemployed, and somehow I found myself doing something that I liked. And over the years, my wife and I, we just managed to pay our bills. So. But the last few years, because of the downturn in the economy, I slowly noticed my credit cards, $3,005, and I think I've got now one credit card, I think it's maxed out around 10, and another one at about, whatever, 3, 4, 5, but, you know, it's like, you turn around and you're trying to run a business, work for yourself, and you get one of these downturns that the banks create, you know, rhythmically, intentionally, adjust these kind of purposes. It's really pretty annoying to understand how the system works. You work your whole lifetime, and at the end of the day, you know, instead of having a little nest egg, you know, to feel comfortable, you're ending up at the end of the day in the red. So you can say, well, you know, it wasn't me. I did good work. I did everything the right way, but, you know, economy is designed that those kind of businesses are marginal. You can't make a decent living because there's too many rent extractions along the way from the landlords, the banks, everything. You know, it's meant to keep people who create real value at just bare subsistence. That's the way the our economy is designed. And, you know, and you can decide to, you know, play the game and go work for Wall Street or, you know, and you can make a lot of money, but, you know, you're going to be doing something that most people probably don't feel good about when they go to get it. You know, it's a trade-off. You know, you want to raise a family and kids, so a lot of people do it. It's understandable, but it seems like you don't have much of a choice, are good choices these days, and it seems that having seen, you know, the last 50, 60 years, the good choices have radically diminished. I mean, I had a lot better choices than I got out of college in 1969, and there are choices now for people. And I got a free education at an excellent city university here, you know, totally free. I came out of college with no debt, because the municipalities had money then to provide public education. It's one of the things that came out of the, you know, the heyday of American capitalism. But now, you know, slowly the bondholders and creditors have extracted so much value away that communities can't provide the kinds of things that they should be providing, and that in the end would be huge payoffs for the community. If you give all the people free education, you're going to have a very healthy workforce. I mean, it's, you know,
it's interesting.
People don't rise up.
Your
debt
levels are increasing. And actually, the most recent census data has shown. Probably seen stories about this in the last week or so.
Levels of household debt are going down, which is intended to send the signal that people are ready to spend again, go out there and spend. But if you look at the data, there's been a redistribution of debt, and a lot of it upwards into age groupings. Elderly are taking on much more debt. And that's just in the last 5 or 6 years or so that the debt burden's been redistributed upwards. Partly as a result of more and more parents co-signing their offspring's student debt loans, and being responsible, finding themselves responsible for them. But there are other reasons also. I think it's an interesting trend that's probably worth analyzing. How the debt load is being redistributed towards the elderly. Where you're repaying it.
I am repaying it.
Yeah. Because what we find is that currently enrolled students don't perceive of their loans as debt. People don't perceive of themselves as debtors until, well, even once they pay, once they have to start paying back the loans, there's a level of recognition, but actually most people don't perceive themselves as debtors until they can't make monthly payments. And then they say, oh, I'm a debtor. But when you're routinely making monthly payments, especially if your bank is making them automatically and you're not even signing anything, which is how banks like to do it these days, then people don't think of themselves as debtors. That's the psychology of the debt. Certainly not currently enrolled students for the most part.
Yeah, it's very hard to organize students around that, especially in the
certainly, yeah.
Now you mentioned in your talk that sometimes people think that the poorer people don't pay much in debt, but just to make a point, people that live in, say, third world poor countries, one of the reasons those countries are poor is because all their natural resources and their indigenous industries have been taken away from them by first world, you know, IMF loans and so forth and so on, that eventually terminated in them being devastated countries that they have to survive in. And similarly, even though we might not think of it in this country that way, but you think about the income tax, you think about the government having to service its debt and taking income from every single American and using a significant portion of that income to service, again, the debt to the bondholders, even people who are that, quote, don't consider themselves in debt. Basically, every American citizen who's paying taxes is in debt, in that sense. The whole system is built on debt.
Well, that's one of the contexts in which you have to see federal student loans also. In class today, Melissa will remember this, we were talking about federal student loans now originate with the government, but the rates of interest are still astronomically high. I mean, they're much higher than the rate at which the government actually borrows money. How do people think about how the government profits from this system? Is it correct to talk about it in terms of profit? We don't really have a culture of thinking that the government profits. But in fact, the government, as we know, is, or the state, is a major agent of the redistribution of wealth. And a lot of that revenue finds itself into private pockets, one way or another, through the redistribution of wealth. A lot of the revenue from student loans goes into trying to pay down the national deficit from war debts. So there are all sorts of private interests that that benefit from that revenue, whether these high rates of interest in federal loans are not, they're not handouts. And in fact, the evidence is that the government, the federal government, recovers 120% of every defaulted loan. That's a considerable rate of profit. At least it has up until now. We don't know what, I think we're moving into new territory at this point with 100 million student defaulters in the last year or so. Ironically, that 1 million, sorry. Ironically, when we started the Occupy Student Debt campaign, we launched a pledge. We tried to use the viral energy of Occupy to do it. people would sign the pledge and pledge to stop paying their loans once a million others had signed up. Didn't really work. But in reality, a million student debtors did default over the course of the next year, but they defaulted individually. So it didn't really have any impact politically. If they defaulted together, it would have had an enormous political impact, which was our gamble when we launched the pledge. We got the numbers right. We just didn't get the signers because it was premature.